do you think India is collecting enough data? And if it is, how close to accurate do you think we are?
India collects an enormous amount of data on a huge range of things, far more than any of us would usually know. You know, I think that's actually quite humbling, and that's one of the great parts of working on this book, which is that you realize that even if you want to look at the share of Indians who go on holidays, for example, or you know, who eats fish in with more fish in which part of the country, these are things that official data collects. These, of course, are sort of more lighthearted things I'm mentioning, but even on all of the most important things that we want to answer about the country do come from official data. Is it enough? Of course not. We could always have, you know, much more. And I think we're really seeing that in the case of COVID. We're seeing that we're highly deficient in sort of, we're not nimble when it comes to data. So when we reached the point of all of the information that we needed on COVID, whether it's the demographic data around cases or whether it is hospitalizations, we've not been able to move fast on that. So I think that sort of nimbleness, then I think frequency is a big issue. We don't collect high frequency data. We need, and you know, we really can't form policy anymore on data that was collected in 2011, as it is the case for the census, for example.
What kind of challenge does it pose for someone like you who is working so closely with data when you do not have enough?
Again, one of the things I do try to make a point of, and I try to make this point especially to people entering the field and to students, is that there is, you know, do try to look for the answers to your questions in the data. So, you know, most of my work does rely on official data, and I do find it, again, quite impressive the number of things that you can still do with it. The problem usually is in accessibility. That can be a big problem. And in sort of context, you know, data is really presented very context-free, and then you need to piece it together through all of this. So yeah, at times there are, you know, envy when you look at website of even say Brazil's health agency or South Africa's, and you can see all of the sort of, I mean, forget the graphs, you know, that even the BMC does a good job of putting out graphs. But I would say the downloadable historical detailed data, there is that envy. But, you know, I try not to make that either an excuse or a stumbling block to say that I can't answer these things because I don't have the data. You sort of find ways to seek out people who do have something. And sometimes you even make do with what's second best, but you sort of do something with what you have.
If there's something you'd like India to focus on when it comes to data collection, what would that be?
I think making raw data open and freely available is something that I would want Indian agencies to do. There's the collection part of it, but then there's all that you put out. You know, and I understand there's a limit to what the government can do in terms of putting out an explanation. So I get it if they only want to put out like a PDF with a sort of summary thing. But have all of the raw data available for downloading and looking at. Again, I'm coming back to the BMC, for example. You know, BMC's COVID dashboard is really the envy of so many cities. It's really held up as a model. And it is great. It does produce all of this data every day. But as you know, everyone in Mumbai who looks at it would know, it's a PDF that updates itself every day. So it's sort of like history begins from day one, and there's, you know, nothing that you have from the previous day. So, you know, there's a Washington Post journalist who recently put out a tweet saying 90% of my job is asking the government for data in the file formats in which they have it, but in which they're not giving it to me. And I really feel that's the case in India as well. You're just, you know, that they have it in usable formats, but they're not sharing it in that way.
While working on this book, and you've definitely sifted through a lot of data, any disturbing or worrying find that you came across?
Three things probably bothered me the most. One is the sort of broad attitudes to civil rights, and you know how low it ranks on sort of Indians' value system largely. That bothers me. Broad opposition to intergroup marriage, whether it is interreligious or intercaste. And, you know, the pervasiveness of that, that's also something that worries me. India follows a system called a principal offense classification when it comes to crimes. What this means is that in every FIR, if there are multiple IPC sections, only the most heinous makes it to the NCIB database, because their, you know, argument is that otherwise it will seem like you're double counting crimes. It's not true. You can have this. So in the case of the 2012 Delhi bus sexual assault, for example, it would have gone down in India's official statistics as a murder and not a sexual assault, because only the most heinous one is used. That bothers me. And of course, the prospect of all that is, you know, lost in the small print is worrying.
Thank you so much, Rukmini, and I wish you all the best for your book. Congratulations again.
Thank you so much for having me, Jay.
Subscribe to Midday India. Get direct notifications on all our videos by clicking on the bell icon.